it's not racism. But it's not the vision of the Quran. Because Allah is very clear. Because there is a dangerous current. Always, it goes to the extreme. Always, you will never accommodate the other person or group on the basis of their difference, and for you to have a sense of actually tolerance. You will never. There is no actually person or group of persons who promote actually fighting or extremism that will ever have a sense or a culture of tolerance. Because tolerance always disappears each time you go to extreme left or extreme right. And if there's any extreme, far north, east, please provide it. The third factor is that there is also a problem of unaddressed problem of the what I call deculturized youth. In this country, and to make this worse, in this part of the country, in the northern part of Nigeria, we have failed to address the problem associated with what I call deculturized youth. Let me give you some statistics that you can understand. Just actually last month, the National Bureau of Statistics and the National Economic Planning and the Central Bank of Nigeria brought out a statistical figure that in Nigeria today, we have 14.7 million youth that are unemployed as graduates. 14.7 million youth that are unemployed as graduates. Graduates here means graduates from secondary school up to university, according to statistics. And the National Bureau of Statistics warned the government and under those federal state local government that all of them, we already go to have, they are sitting on a time bomb in Nigeria. Because you can classify if you like Boko Haram, oh, they are illiterate or they are uneducated, the Western education says blah 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 blah. No. This statistic says those who graduate from secondary school at university level, they are in the number of 14.7 million out of 160. In any country where you allow the youth to be roaming about the streets endlessly and without any sense of actually hope or in a cycle of a sense of hopelessness and frustration, believe you me, you don't need any foreign intervention or foreign force to trigger or aid or convince. But then, this particular group of youth will not only look about endlessly and in a sense of frustration, but the worst thing actually is that they become ready-made recruits for those who want to actually manipulate them and use them to abandon them. And then at the end of the day, nobody goes back to find a way of repairing them. That's the danger. In mature democracies or political advanced economies, they always have some social safety nets. We don't have those social safety nets, and politicians will use children of other people as youth, give them 10,000 to 20,000 naira during campaign, and then they also instigate them to actually fight, make, and kill, and destroy the country of the opponents. And then, when they get election and they are in office, they abandon them. What they start to do, they become ready to recruit, and that's when the danger lies. So, apart from the problem of being unemployed, the graduates among them from secondary school to university are living in a sense of frustration. That's element number two. And the worst thing actually is that the elites who use them and dump them at the end of the day do not know that one day the same after will be recruited by others. And they will be used together. So it will backfire on the same age. So these are the time bombs. And the sooner we begin to address them, the better for us, because there is no sense having actually this kind of disinformation in that context. And I would like to run up actually by saying one other issue that we need to address, you know, has to do with the paradoxes actually of Nigeria. Nigeria's nation is full of paradoxes. We are in a country where we are the second biggest economy in Africa, and we are the largest producer actually of oil in Africa, and we are actually among, you know, the fastest growing economies in the world, but the growth is in poverty, and the growth is not also creating wealth for the majority. And the reason actually for that is one of the paradoxes, that we continue to have an economy that is always, you know, tied. Nigeria is a land of poverty in the midst of plenty. That you have over 70% of Nigerians actually are living in extreme poverty, when it is actually a rich country endowed with over 9,000 natural resources. And 34 natural resources confirmed to be in commercial quantity. And you'll be surprised to know, out of these 34 solid minerals, ranging from gold, bauxite, carbon, etc., 62% are going to be solid minerals, 62% of these solid minerals, you know, that are of commercial quantity, 34, are located in the northern part of Nigeria. And yet, our governments are not making any effort to create activities for investment, nor are they putting their fish together to invest in the natural resources that they have. And the oil and gas is going to dry up, whether we like it or not. The World Bank is actually begging Nigeria last 2 weeks that please, take all right to God, please Nigeria, do not waste your natural resources, especially the oil and gas, money that you're getting, because you are not investing or reinvesting it back to the economy. That is actually a danger for us. And in conclusion, Mr. Chairman, I would like to challenge our PhD research candidate that in the course of his research on this actually topical issue, he should also help us address some of these challenges. One, the challenge of addressing the impact of ethno-religious conflicts in Nigeria on the society and on the internal displaced persons. Because each time we are talking about, you know, violent conflicts, you know, we rush as government and local federal state level with humanitarian relief materials due to the people, and then we don't go back to actually see how they can return safely or they can actually be reintegrated back into society, and we abandon the displaced persons. And we continue to displace citizens arising from all these conflicts over the years, and yet nobody actually takes care or is interested in knowing the negative impact of violent conflicts on the displaced persons. The second actually challenge I would like the session to also help us identify in this research work is the challenge of addressing the negative role of the media in conflict situations. The media is a very powerful tool, and they are actually one of the strongest weapons that you can use to promote the culture of dialogue, the culture of tolerance, and the culture of peace. But the media practitioners themselves have allowed themselves to be used instead of for knowledge and for qualitative information and for investigative journalism. They allow themselves to be used and manipulated by the elite class in Nigeria in very poor and negative reports on conflict, or at times they report on sensationalism, or at times they report without considering their facts, and at the end of the day, they themselves fool the current violent conflicts in Nigeria. So that is one big challenge that we have that we need to address. So we hope your research will also help us to identify the challenge of addressing the negative role of communication or of the media in conflict situations in Nigeria. Finally, I did propose in my presentation the way forward to peace in Nigeria, and I said we must address governance issues. You can't be promoting bad governance. That's what we're promoting, bad governance, especially in northern part of Nigeria. You promote bad governance because you allow corruption to continue to dig and get deeper and deeper in the way we run government. So one of the way forward, if you must actually promote a sustainable peace in this part of the country, is that we must address the issue of bad governance in northern Nigeria. And it's time bomb for us, and whether we like it or not, we must address it. Otherwise, let me give you an example why there is bad governance is more prevalent in the northern Nigeria. I said when we were coming in with the other speakers that look, the entire northeast, northwest, north central put together, economy-wise, controls only the wealth in the banking, insurance, and capital source sector of the Nigerian economy, only 3%. The entire Northwest, North Central, and Northeast put together as the North. We control only 3% of the wealth in the banking, insurance, and capital source sector. The Southwest alone, the Yorubas, control 62.5%. In these three sectors of the economy. That goes to all the banks, and that goes to all the branches, and when you have your own people, they bring them to the branches, and for the rest of us, you serve as a cleaner, you serve as a gateman, and then you serve as a collector of the staff. Why? Why should they invest in their money? Everybody is still in government in Nigeria, all these years. But most people still, they invest in industries, they invest in the success of the economy, they invest in banking, in insurance, and they create wealth and it creates jobs. Our own people who want bad governance, they still enrich corrupt themselves, but they don't create any positive industries. Why? So we must address them. We must stand the cross of our the second issue, a way for peace in Nigeria, particularly not in Nigeria, is that we must also address constitutional reform issues. And one of the core issues is that we must continue to stamp our feet that there is nothing like classification of citizenship in Nigeria. You are a citizen of Nigeria, you are a citizen of Nigeria, and that is all. There is no such classification of citizenship into indigenous and settler. We get the creature of the political elites who want to manipulate access to power and access to resources. But one thing that is protected current with regards to the citizenship in the settler, which is verified not only on the small members of the community, but it's verified even on judges, is a married woman who is from one state, married another person, a husband from a different state. She wants to claim from her state, the state says, hey, once you marry, you've lost your identity of our state. Then she wants to claim from the husband's state, hey, we don't know you here, because you don't belong. We don't belong to this state. The fact that you marry your husband is from Kaduna State doesn't mean that you become a high court judge in Kaduna State. Because there are people who have lined up for years wanting to be appointed high court judges in Kaduna State. And you are from Oyo State or you are from Plateau. This is actually why we must have a common issue. And the point I'm making is that we must have a clause in our constitution that addresses what I call residency right. Residency right. There's a clause on the right of every Nigerian to live in any part of Nigeria, own property in any part of Nigeria, but it needs to be strengthened to be a right in its own, the right of residency. You can move to any part of Nigeria, you have the right to reside, and then you have the right to contest for any election as a fundamental right of the residents. You must only observe a few things. You must abstain for at least 1 year, or 2 years, or 5 years in the constitutional clause that you want to actually propose. But you must also be law-abiding in that particular community, and that should be enough, a license for you. In America, see, Obama was born in Hawaii. He grew up and everything, his work career and everything in the state of Illinois, Chicago. He contested by him from Chicago, not from his place of birth. George Bush Sr., Reagan, all of them, they were from different states of their birth. Move to different state of the actually economic survival, and they, you spend only 1 year in the U.S. Only 1 year in 1 day. Bill Clinton's wife, Hillary Clinton, contested for the federal election. She's actually from different state. She grew up in New York, married Bill Clinton from Arkansas. When he left office, Bill Clinton, that told the people of the U.S., he sent all the best, he fled all the best that was left by the Republican to the Republican president of 1.3 billion naira. But at the end of the second year, Bill Clinton left a positive, actually, result of about $2.1 trillion in the house. You know what? Bill Clinton was looking for $380,000 to buy a house in New York City so that he and his wife and his only actually child, Chelsea, could stay there, reside in that particular house within New York City in order to earn residency right for 1 year, 1 day, so that he can support his wife, Hillary, to contest for the federal election as a senator from the state of New York, representing New York City. You know what Bill Clinton did? He had to borrow money from a banking bank. $380,000, much like the 1%. Here, you put somebody as a government chairman. In 6 months, he can pay $380,000. This is somebody who has actually turned the economy in trillions of US dollars, and yet he left office without $380,000 to buy a house for his family. I conclude. Thank you very much.
Because we all agree that